What's up, punks? It's Shinobi. Today is Wednesday, October 9th, and we are bringing you Block Digest episode 194 at block height 598,622. So, what's up today, Janine? This feels weird passing the hello circle off to you first.
Yeah, I mean, so I just found out that I got accepted for the Lightning Conference, so... Woo! I'm going to be dead to the world for the next 10 days as I try to get that together.
To the Lightning what?
Lightning Conference.
Ah, nice. Congratulations.
Thank you. Shinobi, do you have an announcement?
Well, I might as well put it out there. So, October 19th, I'm going to be giving... the first talk I've ever given at a conference at the Free State Blockchain Digital Assets Conference in New Hampshire, thrown by Bruce Fenton. So, yeah, I guess that's out there. I'm going to be wearing a mask, and none of you fuckers are going to get to see my face. So, haha.
Because it's burned like Joker's, right?
Why would you go and say that?
Actually, I don't know if that's burned or not. I didn't see Batman. Anyway, then it's my announcement now. I'm in a hotel room in the beautiful Transylvania, and I'm going to give a presentation in 3 days. So all of us are doing presentations. Yeah. How are you, Shinobi?
Nervous wreck trying to put a talk together to talk about very, very long-term second layer Bitcoin stuff to a crowd of mostly blockchainers. So this is it's gonna be fun. Literally going into the belly of the beast. Such big Bcash names as Daniel Kravitz and Vin Armani will be there.
You will be, don't worry, you will be Andreas Antonopoulos 2.0.
No. All right then. I guess let's just dive into it, or I'm gonna want to take that Joker opening and rant about that movie for like the next half hour. So Janine, what crazy shit just dropped right before the show?
So I haven't been able to find it yet, but anyway, we last talked about the IRS and their upcoming misguidance in episodes 183 and 185. Essentially, American and or US-based Bitcoiners have been waiting, well, not just Bitcoiners, but every cryptocurrency holder has been waiting for updated guidance on cryptocurrency taxes since 2014, when the IRS released their last misguidance. And the IRS's self-imposed deadline meant that we were supposed to be receiving new guidance months ago, but of course the IRS has no problem breaking its own promises. But according to CoinCenter, the IRS has just issued a new cryptocurrency tax guidance somewhere. I haven't actually had time to find it yet. Maybe it's on their website, or maybe it hasn't been published. Maybe it was sent out to CoinCenter and other interested organizations, but according to Niraj, some portion of that guidance states that if a hard fork is followed by an airdrop and you receive new cryptocurrency, you will have taxable income in the taxable year that you receive that currency. or cryptocurrency. And I should add that the current outdated guidance on their website pretty much says the same thing, so it's not entirely new. In their FAQ, they say, one of my cryptocurrencies went through a hard fork, but I did not receive any new cryptocurrency. Do I have income? And they explain that a hard fork occurs when a cryptocurrency undergoes a protocol change, resulting in a permanent diversion from the legacy distributed ledger. This may result in the creation of a new cryptocurrency on a new distributed ledger, in addition to the legacy cryptocurrency on the legacy distributed ledger. If your cryptocurrency went through a hard fork, but you did not receive any new cryptocurrency, whether through an airdrop, a distribution of cryptocurrency to multiple taxpayers' distributed ledger addresses, or some other kind of transfer, you don't have taxable income. But this still doesn't really clarify things because, well, this will all basically come down to how do they define receive new cryptocurrency? And Niraj says, it seems as though they are defining receipt of cryptocurrency as when someone acquires the ability to transfer, sell, exchange, or otherwise dispose of the cryptocurrency. But again, that's still not quite clear because if you consider people like me, like every time in the history of Bitcoin that a fork coin has come out, I have literally just ignored it. I haven't initialized it in any kind of wallet. I've just pretended it doesn't exist and I never plan to ever acknowledge its existence in any way. So, yeah, of course, as crypto Twitter tends to do, some people, Shinobi, have already announced that they will create fork coins in order to start a never-ending list of new tax liabilities for Americans. Yay!
Hey, why not? I mean, because I don't see the lack of clarity that you do, Janine, because even somebody in your situation, you cannot argue that you do not have the ability to transfer, sell, exchange, or otherwise dispose of those cryptocurrencies. You have those private keys. Like you, there is no reasonable argument you can make. You do not have that ability unless you can literally argue that it is physically impossible for you to somehow get a hold of a wallet for these other currencies with which to use these keys. And that there's no way you can make that argument.
I may have missed it. You might have said it, but how do they price it? Like they look at Bittrex or
It
something
would
like
be
that?
income at the moment of creation. That's generally how income is measured in terms of volatile assets. Like the moment of receipt is the moment that your income is calculated.
Yeah, I mean this. I mean,
But
yeah.
then we don't have the price yet. Sorry, Janine.
No,
Yeah, I
because
mean,
sorry.
I'm less concerned about what price they get. Like, it just boggles my mind that if they knew anything about how this stuff works, how forks work, they would know that this is a giant disaster waiting to happen. Like, this is basically what's happening. If someone, like, it boggles my mind that they would consider each of us responsible for a taxable event that's completely out of our control in terms of how it happened. Like, if it is a taxable event, then it's completely out of my control when someone goes and forks Bitcoin or whatever coin. So it would be like someone literally, like, I'm going to eat shit. It's like someone taking a shit on my doorstep. And it's be like, well, this shit has some kind of value on the market, and therefore, because this random person took a shit on your doorstep and it's on your doorstep, this is a taxable event because you received it and you have to dispose of it. And I'm any reasonable person would respond to that, like, but you didn't ask for a person to shit on your doorstep, and just because you have to dispose of it, or maybe you just completely ignore it and you're okay with shit on your doorstep. It just seems that's a giant disaster waiting to happen.
I don't think the government cares. And like, this is unless there is some miraculous, oh, that's not what we meant after the fact. And I don't think that's going to happen. I mean, this is clearly just so that they can selectively fuck whoever they want. Like literally, like unless you have gone and collected and paid and sold and paid taxes on every single Bitcoin fork that's ever fucking happened. Yeah, there's probably like less than 100 of those people on this planet. You have some way you can get fucked. And they can just selectively fuck you whenever they want because, oopsies, you didn't fucking pay taxes for this obscure court. I mean, that's what the government wants. They don't give a shit about anything except the ability to selectively fuck whoever they want.
I mean, the weird thing is that I assume that they would have to decide what the value of it is based on whether it gets listed on any exchange. Because otherwise, before that point, like, how would they decide what the value is? Even if you received it in, I don't know, January 2015, if it doesn't get listed on an exchange and have any kind of market price that they can actually figure out until a month or two later, how do they decide what it was worth based upon the day that you received it, based on, the forking of the network or whatever? It's just this is not going to work. They're going to have to change it. And the fact that, they spent so much time telling us our guidance is coming, our guidance is coming, and then it comes, and it's like you really didn't think about this at all, did you? So
Well, I think they did. I think they are gonna have to change stuff. And it's real obvious. Oh, that was a fork off Bitcoin. Well, it was clearly worth what Bitcoin was worth at the moment of its creation, until the market takes any other action.
again,
Oopsies, you don't like
every
that? We're the government. We'll throw you in jail. Sorry.
Every coin in its moment of creation worth exactly zero. Like in that moment, in that
Oh no,
millisecond,
but you
it's
see, at the
zero.
moment of its creation, that was Bitcoin, and until it's not. So it's worth what Bitcoin was worth. I'm the government. I can just say whatever the fuck I want, and if you don't do it, I'll throw you in jail.
Do you guys hear it, or is it on my side?
I'm gonna bet that was the phone you were talking about, and
Yeah,
no,
something.
we didn't hear that until your mic was open. But yeah, this is yeah, I am very confident that unless there is a complete about face here, like this was done just to have the ability to selectively enforce against whoever they want, and they'll proceed forward using it. And I mean, you know what I mean? If that's the case, like they're not gonna look at these questions and come up with the reasonable answer to you. They're gonna come up with the answer the government wants to hear, which is, oh, that's worth the same as Bitcoin the moment it forked, until somebody sells it and finds some other price.
Bitfinex.
I guess we can just go into the can of worms. Another can of worms, everybody. Oh my god. Oh my god. Okay. Alrighty. This is going to be long. I'm going to be talking for quite a while, so brace yourselves. First up is a little bit of a check-in with the New York Attorney General's office in New York, and that. And then after that is, oh my God, we'll get to that. So the New York Attorney General's office has filed a letter the end of September, pretty much demanding that the judge who has imposed a moratorium on any kind of requirement to produce documents to the Attorney General for Tether Bitfinex, to demand that they produce documents right now anyway, because if they don't do it right now, they'll never do it. And trying to argue that because some of the things they have requested before the injunction have not been produced, that this stay on producing documents should make an exception to the stuff they really want right now, because they won't get it if they don't get it now. And it's completely insane when you think about the fact that it's the judge's courtroom here. He kind of calls the shots to see how to move forward and handle things. And you effectively have the Attorney General's office now filing a letter complaining about the judge's latest ruling and saying that an exception should be made to that to cater to, if you've followed, our coverage of this story as it's been going on, the crazily arbitrary nonsense that the Attorney General is playing with right here. And to my knowledge, they still have not actually, gone, here's a charge, here's a specific accusation. They just keep attempting to make these vague open-ended document requests and vague open-ended, injunctions against these companies. And this is hitting a fever pitch, with this next situation. And after I'm done first breaking down the situation, I really have only two interpretations of that that I can take away and think they actually make some semblance of rational sense. But there has been a lawsuit filed against Tether, Bitfinex, and a number of individuals associated with those companies. And the richest part about this is Tether literally predicted this before this lawsuit was filed. There was a blog post on October 5th, I believe. Yes. On their website, predicting a bogus, or their exact words, Tether anticipates meritless and mercenary lawsuit based on bogus study. And this lawsuit has actually come to fruition, filed by, and I'm going to say right now, anybody who starts posting a certain kind of comment in response to this is not going to get a good reaction out of me. But David Leibowitz, Benjamin Leibowitz, Jason Leibowitz, Aaron Leibowitz, and Pinchas Goldstein have all filed this suit against all of the numerous Tether and FinEx holding companies, as well as the individuals, Philip Potter, Giancarlo Debasini, and oh my God, Ludovicius, Jean Van Dierwelt, and Reginald Fowler, the individual who was associated with the crypto capital operations we covered a while back, that kind of got hundreds of millions of dollars of FinEx's money confiscated and held by authorities. But all right, now this lawsuit is, let's see, it is based on studies, air quotes, trying to argue that the Tether issuance lines up and improves price manipulation of Bitcoin. And one thing that's really stood out through me going through this whole 95-page document is that for around the first half of it, they just state all of this as facts. Like the first half of this document, I cannot really find many instances of alleged or allegedly or any kind of normal legal language to not just assert your accusations as blanket facts. There was even one point in the lawsuit where they phrase things as the empirical observations. When referring to their accusations. But this is pretty much just trying to, argue the same old nonsense that's been argued by people like Bitfinex. And here's the richest part. The class is literally anybody who transacted in fucking any cryptocurrency since 2014. The sought damages are projected at 1.4 trillion dollars. They're out of their fucking goddamn minds. Like, they're absolutely out of their fucking minds. And to go even a step further, just looking at some of the actual air quote analysis that they're pointing to, trying to actually argue this as a criminal charge in fucking court, part of their argument is that Bitcoin's whole 2017 price pump was Tether. Well, let's see, where was that chart? Oh yeah, What was that? 80% of the current Tether supply was issued after the all-time high in 2017, with the price going down most. Oh wow, that makes a whole lot of sense. So like Tether's entire existence is pumping money out of thin air to manipulate the Bitcoin price and artificially inflate it up, but something like 80% of the Tethers in existence came into existence after the last all-time high, and while the price was trending down for multiple years, very reasonably. And there is even one point where, like, this is the last thing I'm going to go into in this document, because there is just so much absurd, insane shit in this document. But one part I want to quote out exactly. I just need to find this. Sorry. Here we go. So at page 45 in this document, line item 145. Furthermore, in June 2014, 1 month after the Willey report about Mt. Gox was published, and for those who don't know, it was about a price manipulation bot that was running on Mt. Gox. Devasani, Giancarlo, the head of Finex, all but admitted that he was working on a Willy bot of his own to drive the price of Bitcoin to $10,000. Okay, what they're picturing here from Bitcoin Talk is a thread where people are whining about getting wrecked during a short squeeze on Finex, and somebody responding to Giancarlo in this thread, LOL, I didn't know exchange owners browse this mainly trollish speculation forum, wink emoji. Giancarlo, can you get a Willy bot like Carpelli's already and take us to 10,000? Smiley face. Giancarlo replies, currently working on it, ... sticking tongue out emoji. Like, this is literally like a member of a company fucking with somebody on an internet forum who is fucking with them is being cited in a fucking class action lawsuit as actual evidence that this man created a crazy fucking scheme on the scale of billions of dollars to manipulate the Bitcoin. Like these people, like this is point blank either the fucking New York Attorney General's office being the most sociopathic, shady fucking arm of the government I have ever seen, just trying to lob everything that they can at Tether and Finex to see what sticks before they actually try to file charges themselves, or these people filing this lawsuit are just straight up out of their goddamn minds. Like, they're out of their fucking minds. It is one or the other, because there is absolutely nothing else that makes any fucking sense on any level.
As I got into Bitcoin, I was very, very ironic and tried to be funny in a way that just a select few people understand. But I just realized that you can't because people take you seriously. And well, this might be the worst example to do that.
But like, you see how like fucking insane this is, like Nopara? Like, not only does just the most cursory glance at the fucking statistical analysis they're trying to use, that falls apart, but like, it's $1.4 trillion in debt. Like, are you out of your fucking mind? Like,
I mean, that's unreal number. That much money doesn't go.
Sorry, you can go ahead, man.
Yeah, I mean, that much money may did not even go through Bitcoin. Like, if you take the coin market capitalizations, what was the best? $500 billion, maybe that was the best of the whole crypto market cap. And now think about that. That coin market cap capitalization numbers are overinflated, cited by
various sources how wrong they are. It's not happening.
It's like I think that the tell here is going to be whether this gets thrown out or not. Because any sane judge is going to look at this, he's going to throw it out, and he's going to say, if I don't get something actually sane back, this case is done. If this actually moves forward, then something very, very shady is going on underneath this, because this makes no sense in a rational world whatsoever.
Well, I mean, this could be a clue, right? If you are investigating something and looking for clues, okay, this is a clue. Let's try to go to the bottom of it. But if you don't find any other thing that might support that clue or that theory, then you just drop it.
Yeah, I mean, it's gonna be interesting to play out. And as I said, just to wrap this up, if I start seeing comments of a certain kind pop up under this video, people are going to start getting their accounts hidden from this channel, because I'm not gonna deal with that. But on that note, I don't know. I think this is the last like indication of the world losing its mind. Where we're gonna get into today, right, Jenny?
Oh no, I think the world is gonna lose its mind multiple times over as we go through the show.
Okay, well let's get through this next one.
Yeah, so to continue with the theme of misguidance, the Financial Conduct Authority, aka FCA, which in the UK is I don't know what the equivalent is. Like, not quite the IRS. I don't know. What do we have a financial conduct authority in the US? I don't even know.
Maybe like FINRA or something. I don't know.
Yeah, something like that. Anyway, Financial Conduct Authority in the UK, they actually published some guidance themselves on crypto assets back in July 2019, and a particular portion of that guidance has gotten some attention. I don't know if people just didn't get around to reading it or whatever, but it came up recently that in Appendix 1, paragraph 46, they state the following: firms should note that 5 AMLD will be transposed into UK law by 10 January 2020, 10th of January 2020, to introduce AML requirements to certain crypto asset activities. The government has announced that in the UK they will go beyond the scope of 5 AMLD, which proposes to extend AML CTF, which is counterterrorism financing regulation, to entities carrying out the following activities. And then they then provide a list of things, which includes exchange transactions. I mean, that was kind of expected. The issue in new crypto assets, such as through ICOs, again, that's expected. But then at the end, they include, quote, "the publication of open source software, which includes but is not limited to non-custodian wallet software and other types of crypto asset related software." Yeah, so we've talked a little bit about 5AMLD before. It's the Anti-Money Laundering and Counterterrorism Financing Directive for the European Union, which, as they note, is coming into force in January 2020. And the UK, I mean, I don't know. I guess they're going to still apply it too, even though they're not actually going to be in the European Union for some period of time longer. Obviously, the UK does not want to be upstaged when it comes to draconianism. And so, even though they're trying to leave the European continent, of course, they have decided to not only apparently apply these rules to non-custodial software, which is something that I don't think, as far as I know, I don't think the European Union is doing that in their portion of this directive. But they apparently, the UK wants to impose it on the publication of open source software that is not even limited to just operations for cryptocurrencies. Like they say explicitly, not limited to crypto asset related software. So that could be like anything, because it says it's not limited to. They could apply this to any kind of open source software. Now, of course, when they actually enforce it, they're probably going to look at crypto asset related software. But yeah, so that's pretty bad. Now, since I live with a British person, he took a look at it. I don't think he got that far down in the document, so he hasn't read the whole thing, and he didn't want to come on today's show to explain it more because he hadn't finished it. But he thinks that because it's called guidance, that it won't be enforceable law, and I will take that into consideration. But I mean, right in the paragraph, they say that they're going to include that in their incorporation of 5-AMLD in January 2020. So I'm not sure, maybe just didn't finish it, but I don't know. This, it, regardless of whether it actually becomes enforceable law in January, it's really concerning to me that they even would suggest this in the first place. So yeah, the UK, not a great place to live, if you didn't know that already.
You know, when you look at the Earth from space and you see the lines all over, then
nobody can hear you. Come closer to the mic. Also, do you need your mic's open?
No, you can hear something else. I can hear that too when I'm muted.
There we go. Okay, mic is clear. Floor is yours.
Yeah, sorry, it was on me. So, anyway. My point was that you can see the lights everywhere, except in North Korea. Now it's gonna be the same when you look at the Bitcoin nodes all over the world. You can see the nodes everywhere. And in January 2020, you won't be able to see any nodes in the UK.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, that's like, yeah, this is going to be very bad if this actually gets enforced. So, yeah, if you're a Bitcoiner in the UK, you should probably be concerned and do something about this.
Well,
Yeah.
I guess somebody's just gonna have to see how much it costs to drop some binaries down the satlink.
I mean, you don't even need to. It just so here is an idea: add Tor to your Bitcoin wallet, and then put in your terms and conditions that people from the UK cannot use it. But you can't really enforce it because it's over Tor.
I mean, it's like it's absolute like insanity, but it's like it completely fits with the UK. I mean, we are talking about the country that treats kitchen cutlery like assault weapons. I mean, like come on. The British police literally will like take media like opportunities and pictures and shit to be like, look at these knives we got off the street.
Yeah, really
And one
never.
time they had a spoon.
Yeah, you will probably never see a British person more excited than if they're a cop who finds a screwdriver in a bush.
Keeping the streets safe. But it's like, yeah, it's this is it's I think this goes to show that the idea that you can just ignore the government because Bitcoin exists is kind of delusional. You need to take some kind of action against them. And I don't care whether that's legal or democratic or technological. You actually have to take some kind of positive action against them, or they're just going to steamroll over you. They're just going to arbitrarily change the rules in their favor, and the game will go on. And that's something I think that a lot of people in the space need to wrap their head around, because you're not going to win just running software and beating a drum and doing literally nothing else.
Well, I guess this is going to test the censorship resistance of the Bitcoin community in the UK, because maybe they'll just, ignore it.
Yeah, it would be a great test, but it's just not gonna happen. I mean, it's just so unreal.
I mean, what, dude? Anybody in the UK developing software? They're if this goes into effect, they're liable. They can't do that. They have to stop now. They have to take very insane precautions to keep themselves anonymous, and if they get busted, they're fucked. And you have to keep in mind too, they're already publicly known now to be working on this shit, so it's not like they can just reset to total anonymity. Like, they'll be a known person to watch.
Yeah, and there is the problem with anonymous Bitcoin wallets that, well, they can go with your money. That's why we don't even have any, do we?
I don't know, Jean. I guess unless you guys have anything else to pitch on this, you wanna take us into the next one?
Well, I just want to say, I can't remember which exchange it was, but I remember one of the exchanges that when you create an account there, they have this little checkbox that says, if you're a resident of New York City or Iran, you can't create an account, or you have special restrictions on your account. And it's like, well, if this goes through, we're gonna have New York City, UK, and Iran. So welcome to the club, guys.
Woo! Gotta love those arbitrary categories and who gets put in them.
But yeah, so to move on, this is kind of a small update on the whole Quadriga CX situation. If you don't know about that, we've talked about it a number of times in prior episodes, so I'm not even going to list them, and you probably know about it by now. But in short, Quadriga CX was a Canadian-based exchange, and the founder, or one of the founders, Gerald Cotton, died suddenly. And as far as we know, died suddenly. And basically, a bunch of exchange funds disappeared or got lost, keys got lost or whatever. And recently, Jennifer Robertson, who is his widow, released a statement on October 7th, so 2 days ago, that in response to a report by Ernst & Young as trustee in bankruptcy of Quadriga CX, she basically makes a statement. Saying that she's going to voluntarily relinquish a large portion of her assets. I'm trying to figure out if she actually named an amount. I don't think she actually named an amount here, but let me check really quick. I think Bitcoin Magazine cited as like 9 million,
I think
something like that.
that's what I heard.
Yeah, so basically, she says she's going to give over a large sum of money. Of course, I don't think it actually covers the entirety of the amount that is believed to be owed to victims of the exchange. But she also says in the statement, as a result of the monitor's investigation, I've agreed to return to Quadriga CX assets that I had previously thought were purchased with Gary's legitimate earned profits, salary, and dividends. I was upset and disappointed with Gary's activities as uncovered by the investigation when I first learned of them, and continue to be as we conclude the settlement. So she's basically claiming that she was not aware that he was, trading funds that didn't belong to him. And then, of course, a bunch of that ended up being lost due to the fact that he apparently used a very strange and unrecommendable method of key management. So, yeah, that's happened.
Well, I mean, husbands generally don't even tell their wives when they're recklessly gambling with their own money. Why would they tell their wife when they're recklessly gambling with hundreds of millions of dollars of other people's money?
Yeah, I mean it's not an unbelievable statement.
Yeah, that's something I'm much more likely to believe, and I'm gonna lose a lot of respect for people who start like shoving around conspiracy theories about her being in on it and having full knowledge of stuff like that. Like that will make me think that you, one, have no real experience in a relationship, and two, you're just you're a little too obsessed with conspiracy theories.
Yeah, so I just checked. The amount that she plans to relinquish is $9 million or 12 million Canadian dollars. But Ernst & Young had estimated that the missing funds totaled 214.6 million Canadian dollars, only 33 million Canadian dollars of which they were able to recover. So it's a very, very small portion, and that's from Bitcoin Magazine.
No, I mean it's I think that's perfectly reasonable. I mean you can't expect like to just completely like take everything from this woman and leave her penniless because her husband was a completely shady idiot. Like that's just absolutely not a right way to handle that. That's not just. Alrighty, I'm gonna take silence to mean move along. So, next up, just a neat little thing that Grubbles tweeted about on Twitter. So, the Electrum lead maintainer Thomas made a neat little tool that actually takes a serialized Bitcoin transaction and converts it into a mnemonic word set and can actually reverse that back into the hex. And this is really fucking cool. Like, this is pretty much just like a general hex translator into like a mnemonic word set. And like this, I think, is a really cool, really useful thing. I mean, like, the first thing that popped into my head is Blockstream has a that phone number that you can call to verify the block height and the header hash, to kind of compare against the satellite feed. Why couldn't somebody have a call-in phone service to take a transaction and relay it? I mean, we already have people building those kinds of systems for SMS. Why not take that to the level of you could literally do this off a payphone if you can actually find one that still exists somewhere? Or like the ability to kind of intersperse this. I mean, like you could take this to the next level and build a whole other protocol or system for taking these mnemonic words and mixing them into normal looking sentences and post up on message boards or things. Or just a general purpose, like you can transcribe things by hand and be much more certain. I mean it's just a really very simple tool that has a lot of neat potential uses, I think, if you really sit down and play around with it in your head. Like you can build a lot of useful stuff just off this really stupid, simple thing. And ironically, I'm just now seeing a reply to this by Peter Woolla, who is linking to something designed to have a grammar system and actually, make more coherent sentences out of it. So, like, yeah, like this is just the, it's so simple. But I really think you do a lot of cool shit with this. Come on, Nopar, you gotta have something on this one, man.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at it as another tool that might be used that I may use, but I'm really just I can't find use cases, but yeah, it's cool.
Well, I mean, like, here's one, man. Like, let's say you're fucking going on vacation somewhere, like you just write down a bunch of pre-signed transactions to your hot wallet and just phone them in periodically when you need money. And you just have a bunch of random words written down. They're not gonna map to a seed or anything. Like, you know what I mean? You can sprinkle them around or blend them in with things.
Yeah, I mean, humans can communicate to transactions to each other. Sure.
I mean, like, you know, this is the kind of tool, like, think about the very edge. Like, think about the places in the world where it's like, there's no way Bitcoin can work here. Something like this, hey, maybe in a few ways it can.
I guess you can do that for Bitcoin addresses too. That might have some more use case.
Well, I mean, like, think about like a stupid remote place that just has a satellite dish to pick up the Blockstream feed, and literally nothing but a voice line on the phone as like any kind of connection out. Now you can relay your transaction. Before you couldn't, because like, can you imagine the nightmare of trying to like transcribe that in raw hexadecimal?
Boogers guy is asking that what does this tool do? And if I'm not mistaken, it takes a transaction and it creates a long list of mnemonic words, right?
Yeah, it's pretty much like think about like a word seed, except it's a transaction instead of the keys.
All right. If you don't have anything else to add, then I move on to the next one.
No. Yeah.
Move along, little doji.
Doji, Tumblebit. Last time we talked about, I talked about Tumblebit Plus Plus, which is Tumblebit with confidential transactions, and I told you guys that I did not buy the research, but I was very interested that if this is Tumblebit with confidential transactions as confidential transactions on the protocol level, or he's actually using confidential transactions with Tumblebit above the protocol level. So the first one needs consensus change, the second one doesn't. And I was so interested that I bought it, and it's really short. It's very, very short. And it's using it on the protocol level, so it needs consensus change. That was the update there.
Dun 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 dun. Yeah, I want to see this get played with on Liquid. Like, let's do it. Like, come on. Drop everything you're doing and implement this on Liquid Nopar.
I don't know. I just don't know.
Come on, you do not see the usefulness in having a Tumblebit server running on Liquid.
Not really. I mean, it just adds confidential transactions to Tumblebit. It's very minimalistic in that form, and I mean, yeah, that's cool, but you know what would be even cooler and works better and even easier to implement is just add confidential transactions to coin joins. So yeah, if I would go and play with Liquid, then I would play with that and not
But
with this.
the payment hub mode. Payment hub. Come on, Nopar. We can't give up on payment hub mode. We can't give up.
We need more Chinese researchers with very short papers and I am willing to pay $50 for all of them.
All right.
I'm willing to pay gigabyte blocks for them.
Right, so next up is a neat little work in progress that Justin Moon put out there. So he is working on a C Lightning plugin that lets you fund a channel directly from a hardware wallet. So, like, no moving it to the Lightning Nodes hot wallet and then open channel, just directly fund out of the hardware wallet. And it's kind of got me wondering, like, why not, like, take this a step further and set your Lightning Node up so that every channel state is set up so that things wind up going straight back into the hardware wallet. So, we might not have, full hardware like signing for the actual keys for the channel itself, but I mean, this looks like very quickly we could have things going directly out of and back into a hardware wallet to keep the cost down and the efficiency high in terms of like the process of opening and closing channels. And this is just really fucking cool. And this is like just another yet again perfect example of how this whole plugin architecture is just so like empowering for developers. Is look like we look how long has the network been live? Like a year or something now? We still have nothing out there in terms of hardware signing for channels, but hey, the plugin architecture, boom. This is like almost right away, like you can fund out of a chat or your hardware wallet directly out of cold storage and probably with the same amount of effort go right back into it. And like, holy shit, it's because of the plugins. Because you anybody out there can just make a plugin and shove it in there and it does its thing. And that's just fucking awesome.
Yeah, Lightning is getting closer and closer to being actually usable.
Yeah, and I mean, this is why I love, what Blockstream did with the C Lightning architecture so much. It's because like the plugins is like there is no longer like the whole you are not bound by the consensus process of the C Lightning project or even of like the wider Lightning spec. If you want to implement some kind of behavior, you just write your fucking plugin. And like you know what I mean? It's Lightning is already just so much faster moving than the main layer of Bitcoin development because it's not that consensus, protocol. It's something on top of it. And just how you architect the implementation of that second layer protocol, like the way they've done that, is like you're even further like increasing the rate at which development can happen by like just how you've modularized and separated everything to where like anybody can literally just come and do anything and not have to think about like either forking the whole project or like dealing with everybody else and what they want to do.
Yeah, I think it's awesome. I mean, I would love if Bitcoin Core would have this modular architecture where you just fire up the mempool and it's gonna feed you a mempool or something like that. It's really because we are re-implementing a lot of things and this makes things just so much easier for developers, don't have to implement a whole new wallet by themselves, yeah.
I mean, I think that's where they want to go in the long term. It's just like you're starting with the code base that's already there. You know what I mean? That's a whole different thing to try to get to that point from there than start from scratch.
Yeah. Oh, can you remind me again? Is C Lightning is based on Core or not?
It's just a free code base, completely standalone in C, and it's like it is exactly the type of modular architecture that a lot of core developers want in core itself. Like everything is its own daemon with like the interaction isolation between them.
All right, let's move on to async.
All right, so this is pretty cool. So everybody knows, The three major lightning distributions are Eclair from Async, LND from Lightning Labs, and Sea Lightning from Blockstream. And I feel like an absolute fucking asshole because I forget the name of both the implementation and the company. But there's also the Japanese C++ implementation that is trying to pretty much is specializing in like integrated devices and stuff like that. Whereas LND is, concentrating on being the all-in-one software for the home user, and C Lightning is like concentrating on being this high-powered like modular backend for like much more, professional or adaptive uses. And it's like I've always kind of wondered, where Async is planning things. And it's based on just the one thing they've released, the Strike API for merchants, where they can kind of accept payments for you and then batch them out on chain. I've kind of wondered if like their whole game is to try and jump into that merchant services niche. But they have recently raised $8 million in a round. And they're planning on announcing a few new projects coming in the near future, besides Strike and their Eclair wallet. And so I think, this is one. It's nice to see that them actually get some funding and get on some solid ground. Like Lightning went through the $2 million something dollars they raised, and obviously, Blockstream has an enormous amount of funding to funnel towards Lightning. And it's nice to see Async and get themselves on that solid footing. And I think it's also going to be nice, now, with this money kind of secured and the ability to expand the team and work on more, it's going to be interesting to see like where they really concentrate in terms of their niche in Lightning and what they try to specialize in. Because it's pretty clear what all the other companies working on, major implementations are planning in that direction, but it's always kind of been a little unclear from my point of view for Async. And I think, this money and what comes after that is going to bring a little bit of that clarity.
I think you forget to say the main news that how much they raised.
$8 million.
So I have a couple of questions here. I'm not sure you can answer because I was looking at it and I couldn't find it either. But what's really important here is that, all right, they raised $8 million, but what is their valuation, and by extension, what percentage they sold from their company? So, do you know these?
No, I was not able to find any kind of detail like that.
Too bad. They didn't write it down. It's important because if you are looking at the market caps of various coins and you want to compare it to that's what you compare the total valuation.
Oh man. Okay, and real quick, Nayuta was the name of the Japanese company that is developing their own C++ implementation. I had to get that in there. I would have felt like a fucking dick if I didn't actually put their name in this segment somewhere.
Yeah, and they have a very neat looking mobile wallet that's not out yet.
All right, so I guess Janine, back into the land of stupid for a little bit.
Yeah, so I mean, if you know anything about Ethereum, we talked about, I think it was episode 156. I talked about how a large portion of Ethereum, especially the dApps, the so-called dApps, which are not really dApps, rely on Infura, which is basically a node and infrastructure company that was under shared ownership with Consensus. And if you know anything about Consensus, that's basically how they run their whole spoke accelerator type system, where they, invite various projects to become, under shared ownership with Consensus, and they get tons of money from Joseph Lubin, because that's how most of Ethereum is funded, Joseph Lubin. And so Infura has basically been controlling a large portion of the node infrastructure in Ethereum, and it's getting worse and worse. You may have noticed that Joseph Lubin and Vitalik, at a recent event, actually explicitly said that they weren't expecting Ethereum to actually be scalable, to the surprise probably of many people who have been told all of these years that it was scalable. And in fact, even the white paper and the website said it was scalable, and it was conveniently removed rather recently. And so one of those spokes, Infura, has announced, rather not very interestingly, that they've been acquired by Consensus. Now, I said this was not really news and didn't change anything, because, as I said, they were in the hub and spoke model with Consensus already under shared ownership, and so they've now been fully acquired. In the statement, they say every spoke that is incubated by Consensus is able to accelerate their development through access to resources, support, and joint venture opportunities. Over the past few years, Infura has been flattered to receive significant interest from tier one venture capital firms, provided that the future inside Consensus is the best future for our team, our users, and this rapidly growing ecosystem. As a result, we are pleased to announce that Consensus has formally acquired all of the rights to Infura, and Infura will continue as a wholly owned business unit within Consensus. Consensus, which was founded by Joseph Lubin, co-founder of Ethereum, invested in us early. He gave us time to learn, to ramp up, and supported us through our development. As a spoke connected to Consensus Hub, working closely with other spokes across the mesh, not really mesh, we've been able to meaningfully contribute to the growth and adoption of these new decentralized networks, blah, 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 blah. The decision to remain in Consensus doubles down on our collective bet and is a strategy that will enhance our opportunity for deeper collaboration, enabling us to build network effects that will benefit the entire ecosystem. Now, of course, if you've been following me since like the end of 2018-ish, you would have seen that I have been building a super long thread. Specifically, it was originally started to criticize the Civil platform, which is also a Consensus spoke, and I haven't checked recently whether that has changed. But basically, Consensus what or Civil was a blockchain journalism on the blockchain project, and they were like they claimed that they were moving away from the benevolent billionaire model that a lot of journalistic outlets have today, and that they were going to build censorship-resistant journalism. But then, as the late I think the latest. The last time I talked about them was January of this year, and I pointed out that, their Ethereum node hosting was with Infura, which was a Consensus hub, or a Consensus spoke. Their IPFS node hosting was through Infura, which is a Consensus spoke. Their majority funding came from Consensus, and their legal counsel was the Brooklyn Project, which is also from Consensus. So basically, the entire project was controlled by Consensus and Consensus funding. Not very censorship resistant. And so the fact that Infura, which runs their infrastructure and runs a lot of the infrastructure in Ethereum, has now been acquired by Consensus doesn't surprise me, because if you've known, as they've apparently recently admitted, if you've known all this time that Ethereum wasn't going to be scalable, then of course the best business model, if Ethereum is going to continue running at all, is for you to be controlling the infrastructure of the network. Because they I don't know when, but they recently released a paid version of their API access to node service. And so yeah, that's in a network that's becoming increasingly centralized, and no one is able to run their own nodes. That is the winning business model in Ethereum. And it looks like Consensus made the smart decision to, mislead thousand people over the years, that Ethereum is going to scale, and then of course acquire all of the resources necessary to be ready when that lie was finally broken. So good on them.
Breaking news! Ethereum 3.0 design dropped. It's just a database that Consensus runs.
I mean, as far as I can't remember exactly, I don't know if the survey that I mentioned earlier this year, I don't remember if it said how much of the centralized infrastructure that the dApps were relying on was Infura, but I remember it being over 50%, something like that. So literally Consensus could do a 51% attack on Ethereum right now. So that's cool.
Woo! Yeah, this is totally a decentralized, sustainable, open blockchain. That's what Ethereum is. For sure.
Is that still around?
Yep.
Ethereum or Consensus?
Ethereum.
I mean, I'm not sure. I don't actually see people talking about it except to, you know, quietly cry to themselves about how Ethereum is not scalable or something.
Well, you know, it's a shame that somebody couldn't have saved them all years of trouble telling them that ahead of time. You know, real shame nobody could do that. I mean, it's just like, come on. I mean, like, how the fuck do you have this situation and the government looking at this and they go, yep, that's decentralized. It's like, I can't. All right.
Back to more technical developments.
Yay.
Woo! All right, so, you know, fuck the shitcoin stuff. New cold card firmware just dropped. And in addition to a couple fixes regarding multi-sig and key path derivation, there is now a Address Explorer directly on the hardware wallet. That is right. You can get your addresses to send money directly off the fucking hardware wallet. You can go through an Explorer under the advanced menu. It'll show Address Explorer and individually look through the addresses on the screen itself. I think you scroll through sets of 10 at a time. As well, you can dump 250 addresses at a time into a text file CSV that you can export and even verify that against the device. So, you know, this is something that has always bothered me about hardware wallets, just being unable to verify where you're actually having somebody send money. So I just want to say fucking cold card, thank you for actually doing this. Like, how the fuck has this not been a thing since hardware wallets had screens?
I don't know, because so I'm integrating the hardware wallets with HBI, which is, you know, the Bitcoin Core hardware wallet thing that wants to interface all the hardware wallets, and it just, whenever I send the transaction, I'm just so confused. They show me different warnings, different addresses, some of them, I don't know, it's confusing. So yeah, we really need improvement in this.
Yeah, you know, I mean, from my understanding, there's a lot of other hardware wallets don't even check change addresses. Like, this lets you actually check, like, every address, including the one you're manually, like, giving somebody to send you money. Like, you know,
fucking awesome. Yeah, when you want to send the transaction, Then you send the transaction to the hardware wallet, and it's gonna show you that, hey, do you want to send this much money to this address? Oh yeah, I totally do. And hey, do you want to send this much money to this address? What? What's going on? I only want to send one, the first transaction. They show the, I don't know.
Yeah, it's just the point is, like a lot of hardware wallets don't even do the check to make sure your change output is right. And it's like this one lets you verify, like this hardware wallet does all of those checks and lets you manually verify like addresses you are actually giving to other people. Like that absolutely should be a standard feature in every hardware wallet. Like why can I not verify with the hardware I'm actually having somebody send money to an address I have the key to? Oh my God, that was the perfectly timed sneeze right after I got off mic.
Yeah, I find it frustrating. A lot of the hardware wallets, like Trezor, for example, doesn't display change addresses, and so it kind of just looks like your money disappears when you send it. If you don't specify a change address, it just looks like your money disappears, even though it's still there, and it's like, what the hell? And yeah, so that's like, for anyone who tries to do coin management in some of those interfaces, it's a pain in the ass.
Yep. Not no more if
Anyhow,
you got a cold card, though. Booyah! All right.
yeah, let's just say this, that among all the hardware wallets, Cold Card has the worst user interface.
I completely disagree. I just think it's not the kind people are used to.
Yeah, I don't want to go into that. So I will move on to the next topic. And you and user 411 was just ironically pointing out that Wasabi has even worse. And I don't have anything to say to that. Anyway,
Wreck.
because Rick is not here and you guys are pushing the social justice warrior topics onto the digest, I thought I'm going to push developer topics onto the digest, which are both of our stuff are loosely related, but somehow it's related, and at least there is some topics without Rick too. So that's what I'm going to do. And yes, by the way, this episode is totally not like that because we only had Bitcoin topics. Anyway, the first topic.
I was just being a dickhead. You did not stop talking.
Yeah, the first topic I wanted to say is that I just found a great GitHub extension, Chrome extension for GitHub, and it's called Notifier for GitHub, and it notifies you whenever something happens, and it works very, very well with GitHub Refined, which lets you make notifications unread. And there is a great synergy that I think it was unintended, totally unintended, that when you make a GitHub, you make a notification unread with GitHub Refined, then it's not gonna pick it up, so it's not gonna bother you. So it's like you go on the notification, make it read, and on GitHub it's still gonna be there, but it's not gonna bother you with this notifier for GitHub, and it also, I think it's awesome. So, yeah, that was my first topic, and the second topic is even more interesting.
Hold on.
Wait, so
Hold on.
GitHub is being turned into email?
Did you just give up your privacy in yet another way while working on a privacy wallet to get alerts a little easier on GitHub?
Yeah, I totally do. I mean, I really value getting shit done, you know? In fact, I even have a GitHub extension that's a Chrome extension that's called Rescue Time that's totally monitoring everything you do in your Chrome and in your computer, and it creates statistics out of that. Now, this gets into a territory that I'm uncomfortable with, but I'm just curious about statistics.
There is nothing funnier to me than just like I'd like you just like I you throw like your privacy away in all these silly little ways while working on tools for others to protect their privacy. It's just I it's hilarious to me.
I mean, but everyone is doing this because you cannot innovate in every different directions. You have to focus in something, and you have to make sure that you have the optimal environment to reach that goal, and you have to make sacrifices along the process, right?
I know, it's just funny. Just to think about it as like a meme. Like the privacy developer who does not exercise his own privacy.
Yeah, you're on your third strike now because you already got Microsoft Windows, and then you got Google Chrome, and now you have an extension in a browser to track what you're doing and what other people are doing and sending it to you.
You know, yesterday I just asked my girlfriend to take down some photos that she shared with our families, and there was a huge argument. So I want to exercise my right of privacy once in my life, and even that doesn't work out.
Alrighty.
Okay,
So far,
next.
I think I have to ask your permission to do something, right here. Can I
I'm
make a
listening.
Dragon's Den bump about the privacy developer never exercises his own privacy?
You can do whatever you want.
I think we should move on to emotion-driven development.
I'm part of the public domain.
Okay, I'm done. I'm done.
Yeah, me too. Okay, so the next one is really interesting because there might be something revolutionary going on here.
EDD,
So,
not ADD.
ADD, not TDD. Yeah, so this short story. Long story short is that I've been into meditation for a very long time, and I don't really. I mean, I was trying so hard to find good resources on that, but I think I just gave up. The last thing I've read is Meditation Without Bullshit, which was full of bullshit, and I just gave up. I mean, okay, fuck that. I tried 5 million things, and there is just nothing that would get to the level that I'm comfortable with. That, hey, this thing doesn't actually have any contradictions in itself, right? Like, you are not asking much for much. Anyway, so I mean, okay, then let's find something that's maybe vaguely related but at least works. And that's how I arrived to researching a little bit about emotional intelligence. And then I saw that there is a very long research on Yale University. For 20 years, they are researching it, and they created a thing called the mood meter. And this mood meter is actually can be applied to various situations. Don't take my word for it because I'm still getting familiar with it. But I saw that, hey, this can be applied to writing. And I mean, like, hey, if this can be applied to writing, then this surely can be applied to writing software. So that's what I did. And I had an idea. I had an idea to uncover better ways of developing software by combining the two most common abilities of developers are said to possess: systemic thinking and emotional intelligence. And I call this EDD. It's like TDD, test-driven development, but without the T, it's emotion-driven development. So I created a mood meter, but put various things like implementation, code review, refactoring, testing, and I did not really. I mean, I just created it for fun. It took me 2 hours. I didn't really flesh out the ideas. I just put it on GitHub. I did not share it anywhere, and I wake up the next day. Oh man, this has 5 stars and 1 issue. What the heck is happening? If you put something on GitHub, no one's gonna see it until you share it in another platform. So, yeah, I just wanted to share it now that look into that and maybe work it out yourself if you have the time, because I probably won't. It might be an interesting idea and you might be onto something. I don't know, maybe. That's what I wanted to share with it. EDD, emotion driven development.
Well, I mean, it's interesting, but I don't really have any experience to comment on that beyond that. I mean, I have half a mind to put another developer on mic here and let you two just fight.
Yeah, I created another, like, somewhat ironic project too that's called Forever Alone Programming. It's a software development methodology that actually I've been using for a very long time now. And I figured out, hey, we could sell something like FOP certificates. And they could be the FOP masters, like the Scrum masters. And in this EDD concept, you could sell Fun Master certifications. So, yeah, I just threw this idea out. There is a unique in a unique way, and I don't know, it's probably stupid. So let's move on to the next topic, which is, oh, it's still me. Yes, Shinobi.
Go.
Shinobi, your boss has spoken. Your God has spoken.
Nope.
From now on, you have to love Microsoft. I
Nope.
mean, it's not me who's saying this. It's Linus. It's Linus towards himself, the
They're
creator
making
of
him say
Linux.
it. The SJWs are making him say it. He is under duress.
Okay, so when I saw the title in this link that says Linus Torvalds doesn't think Microsoft is out to hijack Linux, and then you translated that in the news desk to Microsoft loves Linux and Linus loves Microsoft. But so if I were to say, like, my significant other is not out to get me, that doesn't automatically translate into they love each other. Like, Those are a bit different. I don't think they love each other. It just means he's not coming up with, theories about how Microsoft is trying to take down Linux. So, because that would be, I mean, that would be stupid. But that doesn't mean they love each other, and
Fair enough.
they're still opposites.
Fair enough. I clickbaited. I'm guilty and I'm going to the clickbait jail.
So,
So,
what does he
what
actually
he
say?
really what he actually said was the whole anti-Microsoft thing was sometimes funny as a joke, but not really. Today they are actually much friendlier. I talk to Microsoft engineers at various conferences and I feel like yes, they have changed. And the engineers are happy. And they are like really happy working on Linux. So I completely dismissed all the anti-Microsoft stuff. And I really love Microsoft.
Nope,
Okay, he didn't
nope,
say it.
yeah, let's try that again.
So, yeah, I mean, if you guys are not aware, but there is a huge change that's going on inside Microsoft for ever since the new CEO came around, right? Steve Ballmer was the CEO before Satya Nadella, and guy who famously said that Linux is a cancer, and Satya Nadella is the guy who famously said that Microsoft loves Linux and Microsoft is open sourcing everything ever since, and things are going very, very well. This might be the only company that's actually only tech company. Like, Google and Apple, their stocks were going down lately, and Microsoft is just not. It's just keeping up and going up instead. So, yeah, things are going great in Microsoft land. Anything to add to this, Shinobi? You love
Yeah, how
Microsoft
come you
now?
didn't talk about that part at the end when, he said that, Microsoft was just like all the other companies that get involved in Linux, and there's always tension and they have their own objectives and stuff, and it wasn't at all in like the super positive light like you're trying to paint it. He just said that they weren't any worse than other companies involved in Linux, pretty much.
Yeah, he just said that whenever a company gets involved in an open source project, there are some tensions, and when Microsoft did this, then there weren't really anything special around it, like, oh, this is an evil company, unlike that other company that came before us. It's nothing special here.
Yeah, it's not anywhere near as positive as you tried to paint it.
I mean,
My ex-girlfriend isn't any worse than all of my other ex-girlfriends.
no, it's not an X.
My
Oh,
current
God.
girlfriend that I occasionally see is not any worse than any of my other girlfriends.
Oh,
Did I just make Linux polyamorous?
oh, kind of is. But should we get to this last kind of serious one, I guess? All right. So this one got put last because not really any other stories it grouped in with, but the first move against ghost guns has happened. So a man was raided by state police and the FBI's Joint Terrorism Task Force and charged with felony possession of firearms, facing up to 25 years in prison with a bond of $100,000 cash. Yeah, and pretty much, you know what he did? He just had these guns without a license, because he lives in New York where there are insane fucking laws. And that's it. That's literally it. Like, he milled weapons himself and possessed them in his home. He was raided by the state police and the FBI's terrorism task force just because he made some guns. Has no criminal record, no fucking history of any kind of violence or antisocial behavior. Just a contractor, lives with his wife and kids, works for a living, and just made some guns. Is now facing 25 years in jail. You know, this is gonna ratchet up. And you might ask what the fuck this has to do with Bitcoin. Well, this whole ghost gun, open source gun movement is the exact same thing as Bitcoin. It is people exerting their rights through technology instead of asking for permission for them. He did nothing violent, has no history of violence or criminal activity. He simply exercised his Second Amendment right in this country to own a gun. And he is now facing 25 years in prison. Like, this is not going to be the last time this happens to people working with open source guns, by a long shot. And this is an interesting route, really, to try to kind of start drawing parallels with things like Bitcoin and try to start shifting that attitude in a more serious way than, oh, people buy drugs with it.
Does it say anything about, like, how did they even know that he had them? Was it
posts on Facebook?
Wow. Weird. That was probably not a smart thing to do, but yeah, that's pretty insane. No criminal history and you get 25 years.
Mm-hmm. So just for, like, exercising a right granted by the foundational document of this fucking country, 25 years in prison. That's insane. That is absolutely insane.
Well, do we have any final thoughts?
Yeah, if governments could find a way to treat Bitcoin the same way that they're going to start treating this open source gun movement, they would do it in a heartbeat.
My final thought is that I'm here in Bratislava. I'm here in Cluj-Napoca for second day already, in the speaker's hotel, and I haven't seen any Bitcoiners. It's like there isn't even a conference here. Maybe it's just a candy camera or something.
They all got kidnapped. It's a honeypot. Get the fuck out of there. Get out. Get out.
They all got bitten by bats and transformed into vampires.
Yeah, I guess, serious note though, I guess, final thoughts from anybody?
I have a very long final thought, so you guys should get yours out.
Go ahead. Shinobi?
No. Yeah, I think I got all mine out in the episode.
Okay, well then my final thought is some insane news that, not totally unexpected, but insane nonetheless, news that has been coming out over the last 2 days, which is that El País, a Spanish media outlet, they've been publishing articles for many months now that were focusing on the surveillance that was conducted on the Ecuadorian embassy while Assange was there by a company called Undercover Global SL. And so this is basically, I'm going to read what I updated my blog post with. basically summaries of what those articles said. And so Undercover Global is currently being investigated by the Spanish High Court. The information that they collected about Assange and his visitors, including detailed documentation and photographs of their bags, computers, electronic devices, and cell phones, was sent to an FTP server in the in a town in the south of Spain, which was the headquarters of Undercover Global. And the CIA allegedly had access. If you want to read more about that, that's in the article, and there's also a background one by a researcher named Kevin, who's been putting out a lot of good articles, and he's summarized basically the mutual antagonism between WikiLeaks and the CIA since 2010. And the theory is that the reason they became involved is because they, quote, recognized a political shift in Ecuador and exploited it in retaliation for the various leaks that WikiLeaks has put out about the CIA over the years. And so, regarding the surveillance in the Ecuadorian embassy, basically visitors who were North Americans, Russians, attorneys, and journalists were special interest targets. And quote, on some occasions, opening basically the security check that they were subjected to upon entering, these people from Undercover Global were opening up the casing of their cell phone in order to locate and photograph its International Mobile Equipment Identity, or the IMEI number, which is a unique code that identifies a device and one of the most valuable pieces of information for anyone looking to hack a phone. When a cell phone connects to a network, this identity number is automatically transmitted. And so, even though this is a Spanish news outlet, actually, all of these articles have a twin in English, so you can read them all in English. But then, let me find it. Where did it go? One second. Back. So, yeah, upon becoming aware of these operations, obviously Assange's defense team filed a criminal complaint, and they hinted that they were, I don't know if they explicitly said that they did this, but they were at least hinting at it. The day before Assange was carried out of the Ecuadorian embassy, they were originally saying that they were just going to file a complaint against Ecuador, and they probably didn't want to reveal the rest of the details, but that complaint eventually resulted in the arrest of the CEO, David Morales, on September 17th, near his company's headquarters. And while he has since been released on bail, quote, his passport was taken from him and his bank accounts frozen. He currently has to check in at the High Court in Spain every 2 weeks, end quote. And the case is being presided over by Judge Jose de la Mata, who recently lifted the secrecy order on the case, which is why we're hearing about all of this now, even though the investigation opened in August. And so the Associated Press also reported that Morales and his company are under investigation for bribery and money laundering. So yeah, that has all come out within the past couple of weeks or so, and hopefully now that there's no secrecy order anymore, we're going to hear a lot more about what's going on with the investigation against them. I think, I don't know if I mentioned it on the show before, but the reason this is important is because if the US government was basically involved in surveillance operations that impacted Assange's attorney-client privilege, that could have implications for the viability of the extradition case, which would be awesome.
Okay, that's not a final thought. That's called a story.
Well, I always leave it till the end because it's not explicitly Bitcoin stuff, but that's like I'm reading this stuff every single day and I can't not talk about it. So
It's a story. Okay, so now that the last story is done, are there any final thoughts?
Jenny is a robot. She doesn't have thoughts.
I have outputs.
Okay. All right. On that note, everybody, we'll catch you
This
next time.
output has now been spent. Thank you.
We should catch you next week, but forgive us if there are any schedule changes or conflicts, given that we're all pretty much speaking places this month. So until next time, adios, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Ясны и дисок моря.